Plaza.
Video was made by Keith Miller of Glasgow and one or two of his friends and colleagues, and clearly they got a lot of pleasure from the project. And that's what this series of programmes is about, making videos. The video recorder has become commonplace in our homes, and it might not be that long before the home video, using one of these, a video camera, becomes just as popular. After all, it's a very pleasant way of extending our creativity, and you can use it for any number of reasons. You might want to document your children growing up,
relive those magical holiday memories.
Staffordshire and Worcestershire Canal.
It's snowing!
Easter Day, 1986.
And it's still snowing!
Sunday.
Just north of Wolverley.
And it's snowing!
Video can be used to convey a strongly felt political message.
14th of January, 1986, 1:35 a.m, Salisbury Plain, England. For the 19th time since its first deployment in March 1984, a cruise missile convoy is terrorising the sleeping British countryside.
You can take your camera almost anywhere to capture the pleasure you get from your favourite hobby. First videos can often look like this. When you start, it can all seem a confusing and difficult process.
It's going to look absolutely terrible. Of course, you're supposed to have a plot, you know. That's the thing, I haven't got a plot. A storyline.
You realise this is sound.
That's right. All you do is we'll see if we fix it up to the television, and then you can all watch it.
There's a vast number of video cameras available on the market, ranging in size from the very small to the fairly substantial, and in price from around £500 right up to £1,500, which is what this one would cost. So obviously, if you're just starting out, rather than splashing out vast sums of money on equipment you're not too sure of, it would make sense to hire from your high street TV rental shop, or if you're lucky, you might be able to hire from a local community media group. There are basically two types of camera which are available. There's one like this, which is a component camera, which you plug into your VHS recorder. Now, that's OK, but it's obviously quite restricting and limiting. So if you want to be more mobile, then you'll need a portable recording unit like this, which can run off mains electricity or batteries. The other type of camera is the camcorder, like this, which has its own cassette recorder incorporated in it, and it's obviously much more portable. Now, you can buy cameras and camcorders for all the most popular tape formats, but they've just started to develop new cassette tapes specifically for use with the camcorder. Two of the more popular ones are this, the VHS-C cassette, which is just a smaller version of an ordinary VHS tape, and that can be used in a VHS recorder if you have an adapter. The other is even smaller. This is the Video 8 format and has enabled us to have really tiny camcorders like that one there. The only thing is that if you want to play this back, you'll have to use a camcorder or have a Video 8 recorder at home. Colin, if someone were just starting, what advice would you give about equipment?
I think we're really talking now about camcorders because they are much easier to use than the two-piece systems. Most of the major problem areas, like focus, exposure and white balance, are all now controlled automatically. So you don't have any problems with that. All you have to do is put the tape in and you're basically ready to go. It may look even among the camcorders as a vast choice, but in fact, there are four manufacturers who make a lot of machines for other companies as well, and they are JVC, Sony, Panasonic and Hitachi. And you will soon find, if you're going around the shops, you'll be able to identify which ones are very, very similar, if not exactly the same. And it also will help you to save money by doing that.
What suggestions do you have about videotape formats?
The full-size, normal VHS ones are obviously the largest and heaviest machines. But I think you'll find that, as most other people in the country at the moment now have VHS recorders, if you simply want to shoot a wedding or a party and give the tape to your relatives or friends, that's the best format to go for. You can edit down from the other formats, but obviously that leads to extra complications. The two ones that you mentioned, specially designed for camcorders, obviously result in smaller, lighter machines. However, they are pretty similar in performance terms. The 8mm does have a better audio system. As for actually looking at individual machines, the best advice is to go into the shop and try them out for ease of use, make sure all the controls fall easily to hand, make sure they're comfortable.
White balance, there you go, white balance.
Once you've bought your camera, you need to learn how to use it, but the instructions aren't always that clear.
If white flashes in the top left of the viewfinder, then the white balance needs adjusting.
Sally Stewart decided she wanted a camera to record her children growing up.
There's a bit.
Do you want to go somewhere?
Yeah.
Lucy, who was three at the time, was dancing in the lounge. She goes to dancing class and she loves dancing. She was dancing up and down so unconsciously. And I said, wouldn't it be lovely if we could just capture this? And Keith said, well, we could if we had a video camera. And that planted the idea, you see.
But the idea turned out to be not as simple as she'd imagined. Buying the camera was just the first step.
So we took the camera home, opened the box, and, well, I was horrified. There were so many wires and plugs and leads and things to do. I didn't know where to start. There was an instruction booklet about this thick, and it was like reading Double Dutch. I couldn't make anything of that at all. So I really thought at that stage that was it. We'd wasted our money. We wouldn't be able to use it. The main problem was, and still is, the colour. Everything seemed to come out blue. Lucy's pink dress was blue and Alan's yellow suit was blue. And I don't know why this is.
Yeah, I see what you mean about this. It's a bit of a business, 40 pages to plough through. It's not much fun, is it?
Hard work.
It doesn't make for interesting reading, really, if you haven't had much experience. Is this how you set it, how you had it set up when you shoot normally?
Yes.
These switches like that?
Yes, it is.
Now, you remember you said that one of your main problems was that you got a sort of blue tinge to your pictures when you were shooting outside.
Yes.
Blue tinge, sort of.
Everything went blue.
Well, I think that's probably because this filter switch here was in the wrong setting. It's set for indoors, that sort of lampshade symbol.
Yes.
And if you're shooting outside, you just flick it down to that. So just put it down to sun.
So there's an indoor and an outdoor switch.
That's right. And you just put it to whichever one's relevant.
Yes.
And the other thing is, there's something about light kept flashing. What do you mean?
When I'm filming, normally indoors, in the viewfinder comes up the word light quite often.
Mm.
Now, I don't know what to do about it, because if I've got all the lights on in the room, I can't give any additional light, but the camera's asking for more light.
Well, you can't give it more light, but that's what this switch is for, the one that's AGC, that's automatic gain control. And it sort of gives it more light, it sort of increases the sensitivity. And if you just put that on, then you should find that flashing light symbol disappears.
Get rid of it. Oh, that's useful.
Mm. Yes. It's really worth spending a bit of time getting to know the controls on your camera. Once you've switched on, The first thing you should decide is whether you're going to be working in natural light or artificial light. Now, all cameras have a filter which must be switched on if you're working indoors. And it's very easy to tell when you play back whether the indoor light filter was on. Correctly set, the picture will look like this. But incorrectly set, the picture will gain a red or orange hue. And if you've left the indoor filter on when you go outside, then there will be a blue hue to your pictures, instead of the correct colours, which should look like this. Many cameras and camcorders have a control for setting what's called the white balance. This is also used to correct the colours of what you're recording. Now, you'll need to correct the colours if you're videoing in the early morning or late afternoon, when the sun is a great orange blob in the sky, or if you're shooting on a very dull, grey, overcast kind of day, or in any situation where there's a mixture of natural and artificial light. It's a very simple process. All you do is get a piece of white card or paper, something that will reflect the light source. You point your camera at it, make sure that the white card fills the picture, and you press your white balance control. And that's all there is to it. The only thing to remember is that it's only applicable to that particular situation. And if you move your camera into different lighting conditions, then you'll have to reset the white balance again. The problem with this picture of the man standing against the window is that the automatic aperture control has adjusted to the light coming through the window. If you adjust the aperture control, sometimes called a backlight control, you can correct for this, but it makes much better sense to reposition your subject if you can. Autofocusing does sound attractive, but it can prove very troublesome. If I point the camera over there, then, okay, it does focus. But if something passes between the camera and the subject, say my hand, then the focus will change because obviously the distance is much shorter. And if things are constantly passing in between the camera and my subject, then the camera will get very confused. So the best thing to do is to put the camera into manual, zoom in very tightly on the subject, use the touch focus button to get it into focus, and then frame up the shot. Now, that might sound pretty daunting, but the best way to get to grips with all these controls is to get your camera and get out there and practice, practice and practice until all of this becomes second nature. Michael Clark, a wildlife illustrator, stills photographer and writer, lives near a nature reserve, and he was eager to try out video.
Well, I'd be really keen to get some pictures of the badgers, because they've, over the years, they've got used to us now. They've started coming up through the orchard, taking lots of still photographs of them, but it's not quite the same as seeing and getting to know them individually with a video camera, I think. That's one of the main interests.
Shall we go inside and have a look at it?
I'd love
to. So we lent Michael a camera and a recorder to find out what he would make of this new technology. Right, well, all the stuff's here.
Oh, tremendous.
Recorder, two batteries.
Yes.
And there's your camera.
Can I touch it?
Yes, I think you have to.
Oh, tremendous. Actually, it's about as light as my still camera. It's just incredibly small.
It's a middle-of-the-range domestic camera with a separate recorder and has all the usual automatic features. Automatic focus, aperture and electric zoom. Yeah, and then tighten it up so that it's as comfortable as possible.
I think I'll use it a lot on the tripod, actually. I like to use the still camera on the tripod more and more as I get older. And so, but that's lovely.
Michael had the use of the camera for several months, and later in the programme we'll find out whether he managed to record his badgers at night.
Quite a good picture of you, and I got some of the statues.
One of the most difficult things to learn is how to hold the camera still. Guess where this is?
This is
the real look out there.
But even with practice, things can easily go wrong, as Kate Douglas discovered when she videoed this procession in France. What were the problems she faced?
Mainly the fact that I was trying to be in the procession itself. It was very important to me and to a lot of other people that we joined in. And that created the problems because you're carrying your video camera on your shoulder and all you can see in front of you are backs. As I didn't have time to plan out the route beforehand, I didn't know where I was going, and I was having to look through the eye of the camera and sort of trying with one eye closed, one eye through the camera, bouncing along and just seeing these up and down movement of people's shoulders and desperately trying to keep my own breath because I was trying to keep up with everybody else, not trip over, and it was a crazy situation. At one stage, there was a statue that was brought out of the church, and I wanted desperately to get a zoom close-up on this. And having just clambered over all the benches and everything to get out of the church, to get round there in front for that shot, I was arrived there so out of breath that I was heaving up and down with the camera, and I couldn't do a thing. I just couldn't get the shot focused. I couldn't zoom in or out without the whole thing shaking. That plus the sun reflecting off the statue, just everything was absolute chaos for that particular shot.
In a later programme, we'll see how Kate successfully videoed another procession.
Often you'll find yourself in a position where you've got to handhold the camera. In fact, a lot of beginners never even bother with a tripod. So it's obviously important to hold the camera in such a way that your pictures are going to be really steady and stable. The first thing then is to make sure that the hand grip is as tight as you can get it. As to the actual position, well, the eyepiece should be as close to your eye as possible. If you're right-handed, then your right elbow should be firmly wedged against your side, and that leaves your left hand free to provide additional support. Again, nice and tight and hugged in close against your body. When you're standing, then you should really have your feet slightly apart, nice and light on your toes, so that your camera's still locked in tight against your body and you can keep camera shake to a minimum. And you should also use your body when you're following somebody. Say you're turning from left to right, well then you should turn from the waist, like that, and not just from the head.
Whenever you can find something to rest on, use it.
You can never get rid of camera shake completely when you're hand-holding, so it makes sense to choose shots where the shake will be a little less obvious. Now, if I take a telephoto shot of those kids over there, it's going to be very wobbly and the picture's going to be quite uncomfortable to look at. The trick is to use the widest picture possible, which means that if I want those kids to look bigger, I've got to move in closer, so that even if I do wobble a little bit, it won't look quite so bad.
No matter how spectacular the scene, bad camera work can ruin it. Keep the shots long and move the camera slowly and smoothly. But most importantly, plan the shots and think about how they will look.
It's a lovely view, peaceful and tranquil, but it's cold and windy. But frankly, I don't know why I'm bothering because you probably can't hear anything I'm saying.
That's better. You can perhaps hear one or two words against the dreadful din of this traffic. And the reason you can just about hear me is that I've got a microphone placed quite close to my mouth. But if we go back to using the microphone on the front of the video camera, then even if I shout, well, it's still windy, but at least it's a generally quieter spot. And it does illustrate how important sound is, because no matter how pretty your pictures are, bad sound can ruin your video. The microphones on video cameras aren't particularly good. They pick up all kinds of noise in the immediate vicinity, whether it's the sound of the motor operating the zoom lens or the roar of traffic. If I stand too far away from the camera, then again, you'll only hear me if I shout. So obviously, have the camera close enough to your subject to be able to pick up whatever he or she might be saying. Yes, that's about right. And remember, don't use the autofocus or electric zoom because the camera mic will pick up the noise of the motors. The only satisfactory solution is to use, thank you, a separate mic. Any microphone that's compatible with your camera will give a better recording than the one that's fixed to it. But in windy conditions like this, you're going to need a windsock, just a piece of felt which you can wrap around it to stop the wind from buffeting the microphone. Now, one of the most useful is a directional mic, so named because it only picks up sound from the direction in which you point it. And all you've got to do then is to rope in a friend. And here she is. Thanks, Anne.
All microphones really need to be held away from the camera, and it's important to monitor the sound using headphones to make sure that what's being recorded is what you want.
Right, if I talk at about this level, is that OK for sound?
Yeah, that's fine for me.
Right. OK. Right, well, here we are in
Michael Clark's orchard, where Michael has been experimenting with the video camera we lent him.
So, Michael, we're back again. How did it go?
Well, I've made a few mistakes, but it's been great fun. It's a marvellous camera, and there's so much potential there. I'm very excited by the whole project. One of the first things I did was set it up for panning along the different grass in the orchard, because the grass is a part of the orchard management. And I found that the automatic focus kept, as the grasses were sort of wandering backwards and forwards in the wind, it kept seeking which one to focus on. And when I played it back, there was this constant click, 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 very unsettling. I also made a lot of noise with the lens when I took the lens cap off. I found that it would often knock in the wind. And there's a bit of Velcro on here. You can actually wedge it into that. But initially, I was very noisy. And you often see people with video cameras on their shoulder, and it looks a very stable sort of way of using a camera. And I tried, and the results I got were wavy, and I didn't like them very much. And you tended to forget you were holding it, and you waved it around too much. So I stuck to the tripod.
Now, let's talk about the badgers, because that's what I really want to know about. How did you get on with shooting them?
Well, it's absolutely amazing. In fact, the results I'm so pleased with. Although the quality is probably not very good from the video appearance compared with, you know, sort of natural history programmes you see on television. But to me, they're really exciting. And with my little spot lamp that I used, I got a lot of pictures of them very successfully. And the movement is so nice, that having for years just taken still photographs, and it's lovely to have the analysis of movement and to choose the sort of pose. You can actually work directly from the video. If you freeze frame, you can go through all the stages. And my own recordings I've done with this of the deer and of the badgers are very helpful for the drawing side.
In the following programmes, we'll be finding out more about the techniques for creating attractive and exciting videos.
We'll be right back.
Whatever you decide to portray, you can, with imaginative camera angles and composition, do much to determine the mood and effect of your video. The difference between a satisfying video and an indifferent one is how well the shots work together. The secret of videoing is to obtain a number of shots which will form a sequence. But to do it successfully, you need to know how different shots follow one another and how best to frame the shots. So I'm going to try to shoot something very simple, a sequence showing this trusty boat here passing through the lock up ahead. Of course, the easiest way to shoot it would be to point the camera with a wide shot and occasionally zoom in and out. Maintaining one shot like this one can become wearying to any audience, even if they have a particular interest in the subject. Simply zooming in and out can look clumsy, ugly, and can be very irritating to watch. Just turning the camera on and off without changing the picture produces a very odd effect. What I really need to do is shoot a variety of different shots, choosing the pictures which will engage your attention. After all, if you were here, your eyes would be continually darting about, picking up different points of interest. And that's really what we should be doing with our video camera, using it as a pair of eyes. I could start with the lock keeper operating the controls, keeping the shot going long enough so that we can see what he's doing. Or I could show the water emptying out of the lock. I could take a picture of the boat waiting for the lock to empty. Clearly, I need a shot of the lock gates opening. And eventually, the picture of the boat leaving the lock. Being able to have a variety of different shots means that we can compress time so that something which actually takes quite a long time to happen can be shown on tape in a matter of moments. So a mixture of different camera positions and an assortment of different pictures can make any situation more interesting to watch than having just one shot maintained for a long time. This video was made by Kate Douglas over a year ago. She made the mistake of trying to video this procession and take part in it at the same time. This year she wanted to video a sponsored walk to raise money to restore an old monastery, but this time Kate was prepared. She had examined the route of the walk, planned what she was going to shoot, and didn't even try to participate in the walk herself. She moved to different locations, leapfrogging the walkers to obtain varied shots in a number of different settings. Kate had to drive ahead of the walkers to give herself time to prepare the shots. I'll just remember. Last time, she was always in the same relative position in the procession, which limited the kinds of pictures she could take. This time, the results were very different. You video, paying attention to the composition of your pictures will help to convey the atmosphere you want. Experiment with your camera to achieve different effects. Out-of-focus shots at times can be just as effective as clear, crisply focused pictures. Here are some very simple ideas of picture composition that you might find helpful, but don't follow them slavishly. The picture of the couple walking looks uncomfortable. We can't see where they're going. Their position in the frame is too far to the left of the picture. If we position them further to the right in the frame, then as they walk, we can anticipate where they're going and can feel more involved with what's happening. The big wheel may be very pretty, but placing the camera square onto it gives it a very flat, uninteresting feel. A more oblique angle, combined with something in the foreground, helps to lead the eye to the wheel and to give a feeling of depth and perspective. Maintaining a wide shot of the dodgems records everything that's happening, but it's all too small in the picture to really know whether people are enjoying themselves, and this picture can very quickly become tiring to watch. Closer shots using the telephoto lens help identify the pleasure of the people on the dodgems and also increases the sense of speed and bad driving. In this shot of the couple walking towards us, it's very easy to be distracted by the bright, confused background. There's nothing which makes us want to look at them. If we move the camera to a more oblique angle with some foreground and then follow them in the picture, they become the center of interest. If we're meant to be looking at the couple, then placing them low down in the picture is a waste. We don't see much of them, and what we see above their heads isn't much of anything. So try and position people in the frame so that their eyes are roughly around the line that marks off the upper third of the picture. This applies to most situations, no matter how close the shot. But the most general rule when taking a shot is to try and consider what is important in it. Decide what you want to show, and then concentrate on shooting it in the most effective manner.
I'll run this one up, and then as soon as it goes into frame on the picture, if you drop...
Peter and Richard Simmons made their first video when they decided it would be an effective way of publicising their local steam society. For them, it was a very carefully planned operation, as they thought it important that it should look good to achieve its purpose.
Well, we're both members of the Coombe Mills Society, and we wanted a means of publicising our activities to local associations, local schools, steaming associations. And although we'd done tape and slide, it's fairly complicated for somebody who doesn't know what they're doing to set up tape and slide successfully. And more people are getting video recorders and playback, so we thought that this was perhaps the way to go. And really, it was an experiment. It gave us a chance to play, and it also provided us with a short publicity film.
The first thing we did was try and write down the story in the storyboard, the kind of list of rough shots.
A storyboard is just a visual plan of the most important shots in a video. Many people find the storyboard useful as it helps determine what they will video and whether it will tell the story they want. And of course, on the day, it reminds them of the shots that they need. You don't have to draw pictures, though. You can simply write down a description of the shot.
Right, when I say go, can you wake up, reach out and switch the light on, and then give a good yawn?
Okay. We've got to start by getting people's attention. That's why we started the way we did. In fact, the beginning we did at the end, because we filmed all the rest of it and then thought, well, how are we going to actually make people sit up and look at this and listen to what we're telling them? If you just start saying it's about a steam engine, then people who are not interested in steam engines switch off. So you've got to try and attract their attention, which is what we did with me getting out of bed.
Yeah, that's fine. Thanks very much.
Okay.
Right.
Right, if you can just hold the card sort of about there in front of the camera.
Richard found that he had to be scrupulous in resetting the white balance when he moved from indoors to outdoors to ensure that the colours came out correctly.
Right, when I say go, what I'd like you to do is to go into the house and then wait a couple of seconds and then come out, shut the door and walk past me to here. OK?
OK, go.
Because of the way video cameras function, it's always advisable to run the camera for 2 or 3 seconds before the point at which you would like to see the shot begin. Again, always leave the camera running 2 or 3 seconds at the end of the shot. What the video camera records is always slightly shorter, as it has to start the tape running at the beginning, and at the end, it clips the recording to prepare for the next shot.
Okay, go.
Richard is building up a sequence of shots which they've already planned to show Peter leaving home in the morning. If we look at how these two shots go together, not only is the time it takes for Peter to walk to the car reduced, but importantly, the shots match each other and cut together. In the first shot, Peter leaves the picture on the right of the frame. The following shot has Peter entering the frame on the left of the picture. This combination produces a smooth flow. But if this shot had been followed by Peter entering on the right of the frame, it would have looked ugly, like this. To maintain a sense of direction between two shots, the subject leaves the picture on one side of the frame and enters the new picture on the other side of the frame. These two shots don't go together very well. If you watch Peter's hands carefully, there's a jump as she appears to put the car key into the door twice. Matching action between two pictures so that it appears to flow continuously is very difficult with home video because of its basic lack of precision.
When I say go.
Richard avoided this difficulty by introducing another shot, that of Peter's face looking down at the car door, as there was less apparent movement and the shots flowed more easily. So, with the additional shot, the picture's now cut together. When they later added commentary, they had the opening sequence to their first ever video.
Good grief. 7 o'clock on a bank holiday morning. Most people who don't have to go to work are still snug in bed. And what am I doing? I mean, by the end of the day, I'll have done more heavy manual work than I usually do in 2 days at work. Still, at least I'm not alone. Some of the crew should already have set to with oil, wood and polish. I bet what they're doing now isn't much different to what some people did in the 19th century.
A wedding is an event that everybody wants to remember.
With this ring...
With this ring...
I thee wed.
Just as no wedding is complete without a photographer, increasingly today, no wedding can be without someone to video the event for posterity. With modern video cameras, we can take successive shots without any disturbance between them. So by just using the camera, we can make a complete video ready to be seen as soon as the wedding is over.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, they're not really interested until we get...
Sid Goring has been making videos of weddings as a hobby for the last couple of years. He's become quite expert, discovering most of the pitfalls.
To prepare, you've got to work out a system of action for the day. And the best way of doing that is to do yourself a storyboard. Every sort of important shot that you're going to do, write it down as a mind jogger on the day.
Sid arrives early at the church so that he can record the surroundings to set the scene for the wedding. All his wedding videos are edited in the camera so that they are immediately available to be watched afterwards. This requires much skill and planning, choosing the right shots and being ready to video at the right moment.
Oh, what a pose, Natty.
He takes close shots of the guests, as not only are they more interesting than wider ones, but the shots flow easily from one to another, as we don't have to worry about the geography of where everyone is standing.
The idea is to get candid shots of the guests. I think that once a person knows he's being recorded, then it's time to stop recording them, because they get all stiff and unnatural and they may do some undignified things that will cause them great embarrassment later on.
A wedding video is going to be watched mainly by friends and relations. They'll probably want to see themselves and everyone else, so Sid tries to include everybody present.
More often than not, the stills photographer will do all my work for me. He sets up the groups, which I take advantage of. He controls the crowd, and in actual fact, I think he's the most important man at the wedding.
So, after the stills photographer has finished his shots, Sid moves in to get his.
Now, if you could put the rings away, just behave naturally and walk slowly towards the church. Okay.
If someone has agreed to be videoed, then they're usually happy to help to make it look good. While shooting this, Sid is anticipating the next event.
Be in a position as well to get the shot of the bridal car in the distance. As it approaches, you go into wide angle, you'll have a great shot of the bride and the father, possibly through the window if there isn't too much reflection on it. The still photographer then will probably open the door for the bride and sit her on the seat with her legs out of the car. And this is a great opportunity to get a close-up of the bride's face. He'll then take a few shots of the bride and the father together.
Hello. Hello, sir.
And providing you don't take too long over it, I'd advise anyone to get these shots and fade out as they're walking towards the church. Otherwise, they're going to beat you to the altar.
As soon as you've got the white balance and you think everything's okay, then fade into a shot, a relative close-up shot of the groom and the best man, exchanging nervous conversation, the way they normally do, or a wide-angle shot of the church.
Thank you.
The position Sid has chosen to video the wedding itself is crucial to the overall quality of the recording, as you can't move around in the church during the ceremony. The camera needs to be positioned so that it can see the faces of the bridal couple, yet remain discreet and unobtrusive.
Gives this woman to be married to this.
You've got to really know before you go into a wedding what a wedding service is all about.
I, Andrew Robert.
I, Andrew Robert.
The experienced professional wedding videographer could probably perform a wedding himself. He knows what word's coming next. He knows when the bride and groom are going to kneel. So then he'd go into a wide angle shot, rather than suddenly have them disappear out of the viewfinder.
In sickness and in health.
Sid knows the words of the wedding ceremony well enough to be able to anticipate when to change the shot and to follow the actions of the participants.
I, Sarah Jane.
I, Sarah Jane.
This is my solemn
vow. This is my solemn vow.
I think the most important thing is that you vary the shot occasionally. Do close-ups and wide-angle shots to sort of vary the mood of the actual ceremony. Perhaps moving from face to face, composing the scene a little bit differently by drawing back on the zoom or zooming in that little bit closer.
I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a sign of our marriage.
As a sign of our marriage.
With my body, I honor you.
With my body, I honor you.
All that I am, I give to you.
All that I am, I give to you.
And all that I have, I share.
And all that I have, I share with you.
Within the love of God.
Within the love of God.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And therefore proclaim that they are husband and wife.
With careful planning, knowledge of the details of the ceremony, and always anticipating the next event, Sid produces excellent wedding videos. But why does he devote so much time to this hobby?
It's a demanding thing to get a wedding recording right. Most of the pleasure comes from getting it right and from seeing the pleasure on the couple's faces when they watch it afterwards.
Welcome once again to the EB Video Show, the letter that's got everything and nothing. Well, you're welcome anyway. Come in.
Hello, and welcome to EB TV. This is the show that goes out when everybody else does. And who can blame them?
Davy, it's 6 months since I last sent you a tape letter, and it's longer than that since you sent me one, so you obviously owe me a tape. I won't hold that against you, because I've got a few bits and pieces that we've filmed during the course of the year, our Malta holiday, and some windsurfing down on the marina. which ended up as a film. It was meant to be just a little insert for you, but ended up as a proper film. I'm going to put that in for you, and we've got a mystery piece a bit later on. Should amuse you. For the moment, we bought a new suite.
Eric Billington's first job 34 years ago aroused a passion in him that's lasted to this day. The job was as a projectionist in a local cinema, and the passion was for making movies. On the streets of Crosby near Liverpool, Eric Billington has become a familiar figure. With the introduction of home video cameras, Eric's passion has taken a new direction, and few of his friends and relatives escape the results. Eric, you've got quite an unusual hobby here. How did you hit on the idea of video letters?
It was a throwback from audio cassette letters, and that was a throwback in turn from bad writing, bad handwriting. I don't like writing letters, and I think you can get more personality into a voice. And then from logical conclusion from that was that a face would be even better still. Well, my father and mother are still okay. Hilda and Bob are fine. Susan and Colin and the family, they're okay. They're away on holiday. And Heather and Adrian are away on holiday with their two kids in Devon at the moment. So if they bring any decent photographs back, then I'll put them on the next tape for you. They developed into video magazines. A little bit of me, a little bit of film taken from outside. If we'd been, say the family had been out for the day, they know my family via video. They've never met them in person, but they know them through the TV screen.
As soon as his wife leaves the house for work, Eric transforms his living room into a full-blown studio. All he needs is his camera and recorder, some lights, a separate microphone, and a TV monitor so he can see how he looks on screen.
Hello, Davey. It's 6 months since I last sent you a tape letter, and it's longer than that since you sent me one, so you obviously owe me a tape. I won't hold that against you.
With the remote control from the camera, Eric can turn himself on and off and check his recordings without moving from the presenter's chair.
Which ended up as a film. It was meant to be just a little insert.
His studio area is actually very small, but when he wants to vary the shot and show more of the room, he uses his wide-angle lens.
Should amuse you. It's one which I bought from a photographic shop. It's just a simple wide-angle adapter for a 35mm camera. And all I do is put it on the front of my own video camera, and it widens the room by twice. For the moment, we bought a new suite. And as you can't see it where the camera is, I'm not going to alter the whole studio setup. So what I'll do is,
I'll pop the wide-angle lens on, and you can see where the last lot of money went to.
Went on this rather nice cottage suite. So things are looking up. Now, what I'm going to do, first of all, is I'm going to introduce you to my surprise, which is some very old film that we found in America. And it's me at 11 years of age, Susan at 2, and the beach as it used to be. So, Davy, that was what I looked like 40 years ago. There's been no improvement.
Although it's fun, you've got quite an impressive-looking light setup. Will you just sort of talk me through it?
Yeah, well, basically, you can just flood the room with one light, but you get no shadows and no interest in the faces. So what I've done, I've got two domestic light fittings, which you buy from any good store, electrical store, that clip onto the furniture. You put 100-watt reflectors, silver-backed reflectors in them. That gives you your background and fill light. And then on two of the stands over here, there's 150 and 100
on there, silver-backed lamps again, which are just fitted into two old chandelier fittings, which are put atop two metal frames, which were cheap screen stands that are bought at a sale for 30 bob each. And I just adapted them, knocked the old screens off because they were broken, fitted the chandelier fittings, the metal tubing, into the top of the lights, and then you just use the ordinary bayonet cap lamp in the top of them. They're, of course, they're adjustable for height, as for professional stuff. And it didn't cost, the whole thing, I suppose, cost £5 for the two. And you can adjust them, move them around the room as you want.
The lighting Eric uses can be applied to any setup. Using lights can make a real difference to the quality of a video. So let's look at their effects in more detail. This is what I looked like with just one powerful light pointing straight at me. You can't see my features very clearly. Everything looks a bit flat. If you turn up the sensitivity on the camera, you overexpose. That's those white patches. If you turn it down, all you get is a mucky splodge. The problem with the TV screen is that it's flat. And if you show a picture on it that doesn't have any shadows, then it looks even flatter. The trick is to acquire depth by creating shadows and using different lighting levels. So let's see what happens when we move our light. Now all the light is coming from one lamp over to one side. This is the main one, so we'll call it the key light. This lights up my face so you can see all the features, but it also creates too much shadow down one side of the face. It looks very dramatic, but it's not very useful. So how do we get rid of these strong, distracting shadows? Well, it's easy. We put another light, a fill light, on the other side to soften them. But don't make this light as powerful as the key light, or you're almost back to square one. Remember, as well as just seeing the whole face, we want to create depth by having different lighting levels. Well, now the face is properly lit, but we still have a problem. With just two strong lights directed onto the face, you run the risk of merging into the background, or in the case of a very dark room like this, of just not seeing any background at all. The solution? Simply throwing some light onto the background. Now both myself and the background are properly lit, and the whole picture has that feeling of depth. Now, we've used proper film lights, but what do you do if your only extra light is a single video lamp at home? This room's probably more like your own living room, except that we can make everything much brighter by switching on that video lamp there, fitted with a 1,000-watt bulb. You have to experiment to find the best position for it, but it's usually a good idea to bounce it off the ceiling or into a corner, wherever it's white or very light. As you can see, it's much better than using no lights, and there is some shadowing, but it still looks pretty flat. So we add another lamp to highlight one side of the face. Now you can see real contrasts, and the picture looks more interesting. If you add a couple more domestic lamps, you can change the background lighting to get a really full effect with plenty of depth. The key lamp we use to create the highlights is just an ordinary desk lamp, except that instead of a 60-watt bulb, we fitted a 275-watt photo flood, which obviously makes it much brighter. But remember, if you do use a photo flood, not to leave it on for too long or the whole lamp will overheat. Again, you have to experiment to find the best position. Just keep fiddling and moving it around and looking at the TV screen until you get the effect that you want. And really, these two lamps on their own should be perfectly adequate because the video lamp itself will provide some general background lighting. Obviously, if you can add a couple of extra background lights, all well and good because it'll give you that extra depth. Now, we've used a couple of desk lamps with ordinary light bulbs in them, but you could get some interesting effects if you were to use, say, coloured light bulbs. Now, so far, this has all been about getting lighting right. But let's just see what would happen if we were to play around with it a little bit.
I say, isn't this exciting?
In this setup, all the light is coming from above and it's making me look quite small and weak. All the detail has gone from the eyes and underneath the chin, and there's a distinct feeling of claustrophobia. Lighting from below gives quite an eerie impression. The shadows on the cheeks accentuate the eyes, and the effect is to make me more dominating and evil.
You can do lots with light to create mood and atmosphere, so don't be afraid to experiment. The makers of this video have made exceptional use of backlighting to create ghostly characters. To create a sinister effect, a single 500-watt lamp was placed at the far end of a smoke-filled tunnel behind the actors playing the ghosts. Richard Simmons belongs to a group of enthusiasts who've restored an old steam engine in a sawmill in Oxfordshire. When making a promotional video about the engine, Richard found he was faced with some particularly challenging lighting problems.
It is very dim and gloomy in there, and there are lots of different levels to the place. I knew that when a film crew films things, they light it, but I'd had no experience at all. My own experience was with sound recording, so we were starting from scratch, really. We optimistically set out with two domestic electric light bulbs in reflectors, and this looked quite good in the little viewfinder on the camera. But when we played back the day's shooting after we'd finished, it was very poor colour, and there were lots of grainy spots on it, and everywhere where the camera or the people moved, it left long smears behind. So effectively, it was just rubbish. We had to scrap the lot. We were a bit heartbroken at that stage. Well, obviously, we had to reshoot it, so I went to a photographer friend of mine and said, look, can you lend me some lights? And what he gave me, in fact, was some photoflood lamps in reflectors. We only had two of these, so we had to do the best we could with just two lamps on stands. And one of the problems is, in here, there's hardly any level places to put stands, so where we put them was more or less where we could. We really just wanted it light all over, and we hoped that that would light up the engine in an interesting way. The main thing, really, was to get the whole thing light, and that's quite difficult with only two lights, actually. The pictures were OK, and the colour was OK and so on, but again, we could have done with even more light because the moving parts, for example, the governor that goes round, tended to look rather ghostly because the image on the camera was smeared. And I think if we'd had more lights, that would have cured it. But we didn't really know how to go about getting more light at the time.
It is possible to hire lights from video workshops or theatrical lighting stores. We asked our own cameraman how he would light the steam engine. He recommended lighting it from all sides and used six redheads, 800-watt lamps, which are widely available. Wherever possible, they were clamped to the ceiling for safety and were then covered with blue gels, also available from hire shops, to colour balance them with the daylight coming through the door and window. It may seem like a lot of effort, but the results show much sharper pictures and truer colours. So how do these compare with Richard's earlier attempts? It's John Palmer's 6th birthday party. All the usual preparations have been carried out. The cake's been baked, games have been planned, the presents wrapped, and the guests invited. But this year, there's one additional ingredient. John's parents have asked their friend Stuart Dolin along to video the occasion.
How are you? Did you have a nice time this morning at the bazaar? Come on in.
For lighting, Stuart has decided that he only needs 2 extra desk lamps at floor level, pointing into the centre of the room to light the children's faces during the party games. To rely solely on ceiling lighting or lamps at tabletop level could have the effect of only illuminating the top of their heads and not their faces. Once the games get underway, the only thing to do is follow the action as it happens.
I don't think you should try and control things like this. I think you're not there to do a mega production. You're there to record the event. So if you're controlling it, then you're changing the thing completely. The only thing I would say is, again, preparation. If you know when certain specific things are about to happen, then you can be in the right place to cover them.
Birthday boy at the top. So if you want to go down, Mark, would you like to sit down that side? Nicola, over the other side with Georgia. And Laura. Lee, up next to Mark. Johnny.
I think the key things to look out for are faces, reactions. Keep your shots tight in on faces. Keep your shots at their level, at their eye level. Keep them low. Don't think that just because you're an adult, everything happens from an adult point of view. A children's party is obviously for children, so pick things up from their eye point.
Oh, yeah. I bet you're all thirsty, aren't you?
Keep shots tight. Don't use lots of wide shots. They're boring, they don't work, they're not interesting. It's children, it's people you're interested in. It's their reactions, it's their personality.
Hold on, we'll say on three, OK? After I've said three. 1, 2, 3.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Johnny, happy birthday to you.
Hooray!
As John's party is in November, the event's rounded off by a bonfire and fireworks. The only illumination available is from the bonfire and a patio floodlamp, so wide shots will have large dark areas and little detail, and too many of them can soon become boring. Tight shots, however, using the light from the bonfire or from fireworks, produce a magical quality all of their own. If you want to get shots where there's no other light available, a torch or two can come in very useful. And remember, don't attempt to follow rockets shooting into the sky. You'll never keep up with them. Instead, go for fireworks that are stationary. Keep the camera steady, and above all, concentrate on faces.
So, off to Malta.
I say, isn't this exciting?
Why do you do it? What do you get out of it, really?
Ego trip. No, I think everybody likes to do something constructive. And you get pleasure from what you're doing. And if the only person that you can actually involve yourself with is yourself, in other words, if you're the only person prepared to sit down in front of that camera and talk or operate the camera or anything else, then you've got to do it on your own.
Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
Early in the morning, we'll be starting out.
Is it really worth it, though, going to all that trouble?
Yes, indeed,
Why?
Because you can play television producers or whatever. It's a fun hobby. If you're going to do it properly, then, you know, you really got to go through the whole thing. It's not just pointing a camera at something. You've got to design your background, see what it's going to look like, light it properly, get your sound balance correct, and then you should look, coming out of a television set, you should actually look as though you've taken the time and trouble to present what you're presenting to somebody else.
Are you regarded as a bit of an oddity in the area, then?
One of the local characters, I suppose, but then there's so many other people around here, it doesn't make any difference one way or the other.
So, it's time, really, for us to go. I'll finish off with the windsurfing film on the end. It's better seen as a complete thing. So, Davey, from Norma and myself and all the gang here, bye-bye. See you.
Video about a nightmarish experience with drugs, the way the images are edited together and the choice of sound combine to evoke a particularly effective atmosphere. The claustrophobic images, which are often repeated, create a sense of never-ending nightmare from which there appears to be no escape. The most enjoyable part of making a video is editing the pictures afterwards to create the mood and the pace that you want. Of course, it also allows you to wipe out those inevitable mistakes and to produce the best possible video from the available material. Now, this is the basic equipment that you'll need. You'll want one video machine to replay your material, another video on which to record, and a television or monitor so that you can see what's going on. You can have any combination of tape formats and machine. For instance, a Video 8 camcorder can be used as the playback machine into a VHS recorder. Use the video sockets to connect the machines together. Video out from the playback machine and the video in for the recording machine. This gives much better quality than using the aerial lead. The process is very simple. We choose the shot that we want to use on the master tape, and decide where we want to start it. Then we rewind for about 10 seconds or so and put it in pause. Now over to the record machine. We decide at which point on the tape we want to begin this recording. Put that into pause and also into record mode. Although, of course, it won't actually begin recording because the pause button's pressed, but we're all ready. Right, so let's begin by setting off the master tape. Remember, there's about 10 seconds before we actually need to begin recording. And at exactly the right point, we release pause. And it started to record.
To just behind the door, somewhere around about there.
Okay.
Peter and Richard Simmons shot their first video to publicise their local steam engine society. They had recorded many hours of material and then had to edit it all together for a video which would last only about 15 minutes.
Right.
They borrowed a second video recorder from a friend and then set to work.
A bit.
They realised that they had to adopt a systematic approach to make sense of all their material.
We looked at what we got to start with, obviously, and made a note of which sections from which shots we actually thought we might use, and marked those up on the storyboard by taking the counter reading from the video we used as our guide.
We then proceeded to copy the shots that we wanted in the order that we wanted them, one by one. And periodically you have to check that what you've done is actually right, because you can't go back and drop one in the middle 5 minutes ago. If you do a shot and you do it slightly wrong, then the next time you copy over, you've got to copy over the end of the previous one, so you lose a bit of your shot. So if you muck it up two or three times, the shot is getting shorter and shorter as you do successive attempts to copy over. And the counters on domestic video recorders are not that accurate. They don't go frame by frame or anything like that. So you can be in for a surprise when it comes up on the screen as to where you are.
There are a few simple points to watch out for when editing. Try and avoid one shot followed by another that looks almost the same. And try and avoid beginning or ending a shot in the middle of a sudden action.
Do you want to keep the jump in, or do you think we ought to go before the jump?
No, we should go before the jump.
Okay, well, we...
There's no fixed way of deciding what shot should follow another. It's all a matter of what feels good and a matter of style. So discussion can be helpful.
Up and down.
Do we have any of the cylinder later on?
Well, look, we could cut it before we start to zoom, so that we lose all... Because it looks silly if you just start to zoom and then cut it out.
Yeah, all right, take all that lot out.
Whip it back on the rewind, and that's the beginning of the next shot.
All right.
OK?
Yeah.
Here we go, then. Go.
How much of Frank do we want?
We've got to wait until his head comes into view at the end of this, because that's what signifies that he'll be talking then on the sound. And then just before the light comes into shot, that's a cut out. There. Yeah. Right.
Yes, I think when you start feeling bored with what you're looking at, that's the time to change. But you've got to be very critical. And we've seen some videos that other colleagues have done where you begin to think, heavens above, we've seen that steam train going round there for 5 minutes. And it may be very interesting if you happen to be interested in that particular steam train. But as a whole, you begin to yawn. And that is the critical point, I think, looking at it from somebody else's point of view, not your own.
The physical action of editing is pretty straightforward. It just requires practice. The hard part comes with the choices and decisions that we have to make. Take a look at this shot. Here we have a young woman walking along. There's nothing to suggest where she's going. And here's a young man walking in a totally different location. These are two apparently unrelated shots. The decisions we make when editing can completely change the impression that the pictures give. so that if I rearrange the pictures, I can alter the storyline. By quick cutting between the two, we're beginning to suggest that there is a connection between them. They might be about to meet up with each other. Now, there's one simple way that you can alter the mood of your video without requiring an extra video recorder. If your machine has an audio dub facility, then you can add music to your pictures. And with appropriate music, we can reinforce the idea that they're about to meet. Now here we have three shots, which depending on the order in which we edit them and the music we dub on, can convey different moods and meaning. Now let's change the order of the shots and use some other background music to convey a different idea. In this home video made by Archie Reed, the music and sound strikingly convey a very definite sense of unease. Now look at it again to see how a different expectation and emotional response can be created by merely changing the music. Adding music to your videos is a very simple procedure. All you have to do is to plug in the source of your music, in this case a cassette recorder, into the audio in socket. Make sure that the tape is wound to the head of the chosen track and put it in pause. And then once you've released the pause button, you can start the audio dub. It's a fairly crude method in that the audio dub facility will wipe out your original sound recording. Now, if you want to keep the original recording and have an additional source of sound like music, then it gets a little tricky. What you can do is to use a stereo video recorder so that you can keep the original sound on one track and record your additional source on another track. It does work, but there is some difficulty in controlling sound levels, and you might find that the music drowns out your original sound. the only way to adequately mix different sound sources is to re-record the original soundtrack onto a sound tape or cassette. But the only thing is that you can't do that with any old tape recorder because of the problems of maintaining synchronization, keeping the picture locked into the sound. Once synchronization is lost, then you start to notice very quickly. For example, if you watch my lips carefully, you'll see that my lip movements aren't exactly matching the sound of my voice right now. You need a control box like this, which picks up the synchronous pulse off the video recorder and controls the speed of a specially modified audio cassette machine. It doesn't have to be as sophisticated as this one, but here I've got a simple mixing unit as well. Now, I've already recorded the original video sound and the vital sync pulse, and on another track, I've got some music. There must be a clear starting point for picture and the sound. I've chosen the first frame of the next shot, and using the frame advance control, I can find the point fairly accurately. Once the picture is at the first frame, all I have to do is to start the audio dub, and the sound tape will automatically begin. Then it's easy. All I have to do is to mix the music with the original sound as often as I like to get the balance right. And then with a bit of luck, it'll not only sound good, it'll still be in sync. If you use any music taken from a record, you have to pay a copyright fee. How much this is depends upon who published it and how much you want to use, but it can work out pretty expensive. However, there are two ways around the problem. One thing you can do is to encourage your friends to compose and play original music for your video and then assign copyright to you. The 70 members of the Skerry Cooperative in Scotland made this video to record a year in the life of their local community. The music is traditional and played by members of the cooperative. The other thing is that you can apply to the Institute of Amateur Cinematographers, who can issue you with a blanket license that'll cover most records. It's valid for a year, covers most music, and only costs a few pounds. If you don't plan to use music in your video but want to create atmosphere with sound effects, then there are special sound effects records that you can buy that are copyright free. Thank you. Douglas has edited the pictures of a video about one of her interests, the architecture of a medieval religious order. While she decided to add music to the video, she also needed commentary to supplement the pictures.
You've got your film, you have got to find some way of livening it up, so it can either be music or commentary or both, and that's what I decided to do, was to add on music to at least keep a general sound going through the whole thing, because I don't think that just watching the picture moving, or not moving in the case of a wall, is that interesting to watch. And then the sound commentary, adding in to give general background information, as it's such a vague subject and not everybody knows about the kind of church architecture that we're trying to show.
Writing words to accompany the pictures in a video is a demanding exercise, as the words not only need to convey what is desired, but must also relate to the pictures. Kate's approach to this task is systematic.
Having looked at it and got a vague idea of timing, then I'll write down what I want to say in addition to what's on film. The background information to the priory, any bits and pieces of information that I can possibly add in. Having got that written down roughly in note form, I'll start writing it out properly. Then I'll try and read it, and hopefully I can read it reasonably well.
It was founded in 1163 as a gift from a grateful Louis VII, who, legend has it, was lost in the vast forest, but was rescued at the spot where the priory stands. It's now owned by a community of Ursuline nuns who use it as a summer retreat. The lay entry is very simple, with no elaborate carving. That's not right.
Yes, I think we'd better make it main church doorway.
Right.
It's often helpful to read the commentary with the pictures to someone else to test out its effectiveness.
Summer retreat. The main church doorway is very simple with no elaborate carving.
Hopefully they don't have too many criticisms to make, but if they do, then accept them, because it's somebody who's impartial, who hasn't seen it before, and who can actually assist.
This lovely park setting.
So what sort of advice might a friend give?
Whether something actually sounds right, whether what I've written down on paper sounds natural enough, whether it is actually a conversation that I'm having with whoever's looking at the video, whether I'm giving over the information that I want to give over in the right way, whether I just sound boring or not.
I suppose it's quite important then that you don't actually speak over everything.
Yeah, there's one section in the film which is the interior of a church, and it's a church which is used now. And I wanted to get the idea of the peace and the quiet and the calm, and to put a commentary over that would have been silly. So I've left it with a bit of music going over it, with no commentary at all, and hopefully the picture then speaks for itself. Forty-eight hours after leaving Craswell, we were in France. Our first stop, about 30 miles south of Paris, in the forest of Rambouillet. I get my final typescript version and sit down with a microphone and a double cassette deck, and I record the commentary right through. The Priory of Louis is one of the better preserved of the remaining Grandmontane cells.
Once Kate has recorded the commentary, she mixes it with the music using the double cassette deck. The commentary is on one audio cassette, and the music is on the other.
It was rescued at the spot where the priory stands. It is now owned by a community of Ursuline nuns.
I'm looking at the film, and I know which section's coming up next, so I just need to release the pause button, get to the end of that section, pause again, and so on throughout the whole thing.
Kate, what would you say the most important thing is that you've learnt from writing commentaries?
I think basically keep it short. Keep the commentary as brief as you can and as to the point as you can. Keep it cheerful. Try and get it interesting.
Several major Russian nuclear silos.
The end of the world, a fairly spectacular event which can be recorded at remarkably little expense these days, thanks to home video.
We've just received a telex from London. Can we confirm this? Keep quiet. We're on the air. We have a confirmed report.
One way to create excitement and visual impact in your video is to use special effects. You don't need expensive equipment, just the knowledge of a few simple techniques which can transform any production.
It's massive.
Stop babbling and get ready. Where would you like to go?
It would be nice to go to Scotland.
Then you shall.
All these clips are from a two-hour fantasy video. It was made by this man, 20-year-old Richard Crooks.
We are the robots. We are the robots.
Richard has spent the past year experimenting with new ideas for the video, which he not only wrote, but also recorded, directed, edited, and starred in. But what is it about special effects that really fascinates Richard?
They really create the mood and atmosphere of the film, and they can be used for very spectacular scenes to make it look really impressive and exciting.
Yes, she's gone, but the outside has picked her up on the radar as a nuclear warhead. They have just launched a billion megatons of total destruction.
There was a scene where there's a nuclear explosion in the film, and you see lots and lots of people charging down the streets, and just mass panic, really. We had the Suffolk police there to help organise it and make sure nothing went wrong. I like watching science fiction films and that kind of thing. I see an effect on there and I always like to know how it's done.
Today, Richard and his friend Jane are working on the Tower of Dreams sequence. The tower itself is 6 inches high and painted on a sheet of glass. Through the viewfinder, it looks like this.
Right, over more, Richard. Right, over a bit more. Stop, back a little bit. Okay, ready to shoot now? Right. All right, I'm filming now, okay?
I've used lots of filter effects in the film and to create the atmosphere and the mood of the film. What I've used in my film are these graduated filters. They can change the colour of the sky, or you can have them up the other way to change the colour of the earth.
And this is the effect of using a graduated filter. The coloured filters Richard uses are widely available, but it's also possible to make your own using sheets of coloured acetate or even sweet wrappers. But for some of the more sophisticated effects, photographic filters are necessary.
There is the centre spot that I've used in the windmill scene. That just gives this green haze around the edge of what you're doing, and then the focal point, the central point you want, is clear in the middle of it. You can have this hazy stuff around the outside. This is a multiple image filter. My assistant Jane, she twisted it and made that funny effect just before I went into the can of drink. This is one I made myself. It's just a piece of cardboard with a shape cut out. It was actually used for the when I looked down into the fizzy drinks can at the beginning of the film. This is the most expensive filter. It's called a mirage filter. It's just a mirror which you can put in front of the lens and which reflects the top half or the bottom half, whatever you want. Like, I used it in with the windmill to create a lake in front of the windmill.
Here, in his bedroom, Richard's preparing to film his face on the wall. He fits the mirage filter onto the camera and adjusts the angle until the effect displayed on the TV screen is the one that he wants. When he's ready to record, he puts on his dark glasses and slides into position.
Generator. It costs about £300, but the Haverhill Youth Centre let me borrow it. What it does really is you superimpose titles over pre-recorded material such as this. But what I wanted it for is to have two laser beams coming from these two robots to strike these bricks here, which there is a flash pot which caused an explosion. So what I did, I got a pencil, I just mark out where they're, I want the laser beam to come from.
From their eyes?
From their eyes, to hit the ground here. Mm-hmm. Then I just draw lines to make the laser effect. So I just join up with the left.
Mm-hmm. Down to the flash point.
Down to the flash point. From the right.
That's the right robot's eye.
Down to the flash point. Then I just place this back.
And the two black lines will show up. Oh, just as.
Just like that.
Just like lasers. Now, you've got it all set up, but that's obviously a freeze frame. It's mm-hmm. not actually on the tape yet. How do you do that?
Well, what I do is when the explosion appears, I just go quickly flash it on and off like that. And then the explosion will occur, and then just the tables just start running.
For the sake of his video, there's no limit to what Richard's prepared to do. Even when pursuing realistic effects, his dedication knows no bounds.
We actually went to a hospital in Livingston, and they took about a pint of blood from me, and I was sort of making sure all the camera work was going okay and everything, and then afterwards I just fainted after everything.
This is a home movie, a Super 8 film shot by a friend of mine, which I've just transferred onto video. Now, there are a number of ways in which you can do this. On this occasion, I used this piece of equipment, a home telecine adapter. Now, it's not too difficult to use. What you have to do is to get your video camera lens right up close against this close-up lens on the side here. And then make sure that the cine projector is facing this screen and close enough to it so that any pictures will completely fill the screen. So all you've got to do is to focus and set the white balance and you're all ready to record. Now, although video cameras run at 25 frames a second, this adapter is designed to work best with film projected at 20 frames a second. So if your projector only runs at 18 or 24 frames a second like mine, then you're probably going to get some flicker on your video copy. And the only way to get rid of it is if your projector has a variable speed control. These machines aren't cheap, so if I were you, I'd take your own projector to the shop to try it out before you even think of buying one. But there is another way of transferring film and slides onto video, and that's using one of these glass screens. It's just made up of two sheets of glass set slightly apart with a special fluid in the middle. If you want to record film, you project it onto this mirror here, which then reflects the image onto the screen where it's recorded by the video camera, which is placed around the other side. But there are two other problems with transferring film to video. One is in getting the correct colour balance. And there's very little you can do about this, except experimenting with the colour balance control on your camera. The other problem only arises when you're also transferring sound, because obviously if you're altering the speed of the film, then any soundtrack will automatically be distorted. But sound isn't a problem when you're transferring slides to video, because you can add your commentary and music later on. Using this glass screen, what we do is we abandon the mirror and replace it with a slide projector and simply project the slide straight onto the back of the screen. A little adjustment for focusing and you're away. All set to turn your holiday slides into your holiday video. For many years, Miles Pollock has nurtured a secret ambition to record onto video one very special occasion.
I want to make a video of my wedding, which was 17 years ago. So I have got a colour film which my father-in-law took. I have got black and white stills which my friends took. I have got colour transparencies which my friends took. And of course I have the souvenir wedding album, black and white. I also taped on audio tape the wedding service, and I want to bring all those together to make one video so that I can sit and watch my wedding from 17 years ago.
To transfer his film, Miles uses a white laminate shelf to act as a screen. He props it about 2 feet in front of his projector to enable him to get a small picture with a sharp, well-defined focus. The video camera is positioned very close to the cine projector to reduce the angle of recording and keep any distortion to a minimum. The film is set to run, and the speed is varied on the projector to compensate for any flicker he may get on his recorded image. Once Miles is satisfied with the results on his video camera, he's all ready to record.
Miles, you've also got lots of slides which you want to put on your tape. How are you going to deal with that?
What I use is a music stand, because we are a very musical family. And I bring it very close to the camera, because I'm going to use the macro lens on the camera, which enables me to film very, 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 very close to the slide. I can now put this on the stand, and you can see the picture on the television screen.
Mm-hmm. Now it's very dark.
Well, I must focus it first. So now I bring it into focus, and the picture is not much to write home about.
No, it isn't really, is it?
In fact, what we need is a bit of light behind. Mm. So, from my bedroom, I brought down my reading lamp, which is a standard 60-watt bulb, so fairly low power, and I can shine it behind the transparency, and now suddenly it's full of colour and light.
Yes, it's a lot brighter, but you can actually see the rim of the bedside lamp, which isn't too good. And I suppose also you must be very careful that you don't shine the light directly down the camera, because it could burn out the tube, and then you get that horrible spotting, which wouldn't,
quite right,
wouldn't
quite
do
right.
at all.
You should always have something between the light and the camera. Now, I use an ice cream lid. So I remove the transparency and put the ice cream lid there, and put the transparency between the ice cream lid and the camera. It acts as a diffuser. It diffuses the light all over the transparency. Now if I switch my bedside light on, suddenly we get a brilliant picture. And I have the ability, of course, of moving the light and making that picture how I want it to appear on the video. I can have highlights, low lights, do away with the contrast, have it very, very bright, or, as I think for this particular slide, somewhat romantic.
So is it really worth the effort making a video?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. If you watch the film, you don't have the sound. If you have the sound, which I listened to on my anniversary, you don't have the film. I don't even have a slide projector, but I've got a video recorder, I've got a television, I can watch it whenever I like.
Those whom God has joined together, let no man put asunder. I pronounce that they be man and wife together, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
A different special effects technique is used in this video by Chris Stiles and David Munnels. From the television screen emerges the hand of a monster, with elongated latex fingers and smothered in treacle. The secret of this effect is that this TV set has had its insides removed and the screen replaced with a piece of white paper. Then the TV image is projected onto this from a cine projector, which is hidden to the right of this shot. Animation was the method chosen by Julian Kirk for his first video, Motor Race, made while still a student at Canterbury College of Art.
Well, it's about this fellow Vernon, this old man who's in a garage. And he has an old car in his garage, and he loves it. And whenever he looks at it, he tends to think about what it used to be a young man and be a racing driver.
To distinguish his central character from the others in the video, Julian used plasticine models rather than paper cutouts. He made two bodies for the young Vernon and gave him four interchangeable heads with different expressions. The car was built in two sizes to allow a greater selection of shots.
To make the models move, it was a question of, instead of moving them a bit and then taking a separate frame and then stopping and moving again and that sort of way. It's very laborious. We just trained the camera onto his top half and I held the bottom half and moved him like that sort of to look as if he was walking. And it was, I suppose it was quite time-saving, really, because it would have taken ages otherwise if he'd done it.
Recording the race was fairly straightforward, but very time-consuming and needed the help of colleagues. Paper cut-out cars were stuck onto a sheet of glass and a piece of clear acetate supporting Vernon's car was placed on top of them.
Okay. It's just in the shot.
It's going to run over his wheel.
The road was a roll of painted wallpaper that was pulled underneath the glass.
Just hang on, let me just check the focus.
The camera was positioned directly above the workbench to get a bird's eye view of the race.
Okay.
Let's see if we get it. Ready?
Yeah.
When they were ready to record, Julian pulled the road underneath the glass while one of his friends pulled the acetate with the car in the opposite direction.
Great.
To create the idea of speed and tension, Julian needed a huge variety of shots, and so the race had to be filmed many times with the camera in different positions.
It must have been about an hour that was edited down. Obviously, most of it was rejected, either because of pulling the road through, it had fallen off the rostrum, or his head had fallen off, or the model had fallen over, the background had collapsed, or someone had laughed, or got in front of the camera. He's the old man again. Rather sad.
Hey? What? What, now? Oh, for heaven's sake.
What do you think you've learnt from it, Julian?
I don't know. Well, when I started it, I knew nothing, and now I know very little. But it's a start, you know.
We'll be right back.
These are the opening scenes of The Haunting, a video shot on location at Swindon Media Arts Lab, a place where anyone who wants to make videos can hire equipment and learn how to use it. No experience is needed, just an idea and the enthusiasm to turn it into a video. Another video made with equipment and assistance from Media Arts. It was made by a group of local Swindon punks who did all their own camera work and sound recording.
It was four of us that made it. Me, Mickey, Pat, Kelly. Kelly comes from America, but she just sort of just moved over here then when we first started to make the video. It's been made mainly because we want to achieve something with it and to get closer to other people and to put our point of view over.
Media Arts is a workshop, an access workshop, based at the Old Town Hall in Swindon, which has been converted into an arts centre. What we do here is we teach people to make video programmes and indeed work in film or audio or photography. We provide production facilities for people to make material of their choosing in those areas. And we also show material. Exhibition's very much part of our strategy as well.
Fran Wildish is the mother of a dyslexic child and one of the organisers of Swindon Dyslexia Association. Despite having no previous experience of video, she became involved in producing one to make local teachers more aware of the problems dyslexic children face.
Well, I got involved because I'm a parent in the Dyslexic Association, I'm not a teacher. I read in the newsletter that they wanted someone to do it because they didn't have the time or feel they could do it. And I thought, oh, sounds interesting, I'll go along and see.
If you'd like to do white balance.
Rob Watling is one of the workers at Media Arts who helped train Fran to use some of the centre's semi-professional U-matic equipment. Fran and her partner Sue Thurtle, a teacher of dyslexic children, have decided that they want to start their video with vox pops of people talking about dyslexia. They feel it's a good way to highlight the general lack of understanding about this subject.
And do you know if there's anything that we can do for people who have dyslexia? Okay? Is that all right?
Yes.
Is that on, Sue?
Yes, on.
Right.
If you could just move around a bit. And the people here are making a programme about children, and there's a couple of questions I want to ask you. Could you just come slightly further around? That's better. You ready?
Take running.
Hello, can you tell me what you know about dyslexia?
In the finished video, these sequences will be edited together.
Okay.
Oh, that was lovely, yes. Good. Super.
Hello, can you tell me what you know about dyslexia? Not much.
Not a lot.
No. Nothing. Nothing at all.
Hello, I suffer from a specific reading and spelling difficulty called dyslexia. Now, a lot of people say, oh, dyslexia, it doesn't exist, but I can tell you it certainly does, and I have it.
We wanted someone who was immediately identifiable by most people as someone who has got dyslexia, and so we thought of Susan Hampshire, and she very kindly agreed to come and help us with the video. Right.
Using the workshop's U-matic editing suite, Fran and Sue cut together their video. This gives them more accurate edits and a more professional finish than they get from a normal domestic format.
A cup is a cup.
Yes, I wish we'd had a white cup.
Or the dyslexic child.
Yes, it doesn't show up.
But a letter very much depends.
Now that's clear. The tile looks good, isn't it?
Yes. That other bit worked quite well, didn't it?
Yes. To do the... Well, yes, we need, I think, the cat graphics after this.
Yes, OK. Right. I'm not a technical person at all. The idea of all these dials and knobs was not going to work for me, I was convinced, but it really has. I'm very surprised. It's very, very creative, very interesting. It's very enjoyable to be able to put pictures of a sound, sound of a pictures, and to rearrange what people have actually said. It's a great deal of power. OK, that's good. So that's about 14.
For Fran and Sue, making this video has meant additional demands on their already crowded working days.
The 1981 Education Act, in terms of the special education needs of children.
Our family commitments have made it quite difficult for us to finish the video as quickly as we would have liked. It's meant that we've spent a lot of time in the evenings, and in the daytime we've had to find some way of coping with children and coping with our work commitments. So it's been rather difficult to get everything done in time.
Education Act. So what interest has been shown in the video?
A lot of heads are interested in us taking the video into schools. They've asked us about it, the people involved in it, and they seem very keen to get it into schools. We've also been asked by the County Hall to take a rough copy of our video in, and we did show this, not the finished one, obviously, but the rough cut to County Hall, to the Working Party on Dyslexia, and that seemed to be very well received.
Our training work is not just about how to use the equipment. It's about the way images work, about the way meaning's conveyed in different styles. We talk to people about documentary, drama documentary, fiction, the different styles, the way that helps you communicate. What we like to think we're trying to do there is help people choose the best vehicle for their particular message.
Hardcore interview with general public, scene one, act one.
They want to be born again and grow up. I mean, I think they're absolutely disgusting. I'm just wondering what the world's going to come to.
This is called the generation gap.
So it's completely unacceptable, isn't it?
No, they're all rubbish.
They're all rubbish?
Yeah, don't agree with it.
Why not?
Christ. Oh, I don't know, really.
Makeup.
Down and out. Do you think that they're perhaps being deliberately shocking? I wouldn't have even thought they'd been shocking at all.
Shocking,
oh. Disgraceful.
Disgraceful?
Disgraceful, yeah.
Why'd you say that?
Oh, the one over there now. I mean, look at the state of that.
Cut.
Action. Right. Go back.
Here, another group from the centre is making a ghost story.
Back. Going forward.
Playing the part of the ghost is Tom Brown. He became involved in various video projects after a long illness.
You need to decide who's going to be doing sound and who's going to be on camera.
I'll take Mike.
You'll go on the microphone.
Here, he's working with other people from the centre, making a video for a group called Self Start.
We're making a video film about Self Start, Self Start being an organisation which is very... rebuilding of a person's confidence. That is their main aim in life. And we feel that this is an important project to be able to sort of make a video film about this, to be able to show to the people, to sort of advertise this fact to the public.
Just getting the floor.
These people, like Tom, are ex-members of Self Start, who had problems as a result of being housebound. They've come along today to take part in an exercise to rebuild self-confidence. It's a reconstruction of the first day where they play various word games as a way of getting to know each other.
You do in an induction session.
Yep. I'm Kevin, and I'm unique because I got a tattoo on my leg.
What part of your leg?
I'm Panther, and I'm unique because I've got contact lenses.
I'm Peter and I'm unique because I never wash my hair.
I'm Mike and I'm unique because I've got a blue t-shirt on.
I'm Anne and I'm unique because I've got a pink jumper on.
I'm Panther and I'm unique because I've got a pale blue sweatshirt on.
I'm Chris, I'm unique. I've been married 4 times and looking for a fifth.
Oh, that's not true, isn't it?
Yeah, so I'm sitting next to sexy Sheila.
To me. I'm unique because I've never been married and I don't want to, thank you very much.
That leaves me out.
Tom hopes that the video will help and encourage other people with similar problems to join Self-Start. He feels that working as a team and learning to use the equipment has helped him a lot.
Once you know the equipment, you can go on and expand your own artistic skills and thereby your own confidence. And this is what it's done for me. Having had problems with my eyes through diabetes coupled with slightly high blood pressure, it gave me very misty sight. And this is slowly getting better, but in the meanwhile, I had lost a lot of my own personal confidence.
And on playback, it's okay, so we can trust it, so don't worry too much.
Through the tutoring in Self-Start and in Media Arts, these people have proved to me that I can. Well, they made me prove it to myself by handling the equipment, by saying, look, there's a camera, there's a tape recorder, you know, you go and use it.
Yeah. Okay,
hey, yo!
Right, listen up, actors, you're directing, OK?
As well as welcoming people who come to the centre to make videos, Media Arts have a policy of going to youth groups and community centres, encouraging people who wouldn't normally use video to experiment with it. Here, under the guidance of Mark Parkin, a group at the Plus One Youth Centre are rehearsing their first video.
We'll cut some kind of order, but it only needs to last about 30 seconds. And then after that, we'll go to the shot or the routine and start doing that with some music. OK.
Action.
Yo,
yeah,
Dean, right, what's happening?
Yeah.
Alright?
Yeah. Yes, what's your scratching like lately?
Scratching's alright. What are you like lately?
Yeah, alright.
Alright.
Yeah. Mate, I bought any records in.
Alright, yeah, I bought nothing new records. Yeah. Right, you want to hear some, huh?
Yeah, we want to practice our new routine.
Yeah.
We've got this routine, guys, bad. You've got to check it out.
It's bad, huh? You want to check it out, right?
Right.
What, pick a record then?
Pick a record and then
it's got to fit the routine, innit?
Brand new routine, new record.
Hey, what's that? What's that?
It's fresh. Yeah, cut.
Yeah, yeah. Listen, you two, right? You come in, right? And when you ask him to pop nothing and you say you're not going to play a record, you beatbox, right? Just beatbox. Right, because you don't, it's too stiff, man. Mm. Too stiff. I mean, just try, you try a beatbox, right? Oh, and a bit of popping.
You say we don't need no record, we got this human radio box here or
that's
something.
That's it. And you're a natural, man. Don't flow down. Just keep it going.
You say, yeah, that's good, but my records are still hard or something.
Yeah. He keeps on going. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Just try it again, all right. But hey, you got about 20 seconds to get it all in. All right.
Action. Yeah, right, Leo?
Yo, D! Yeah, right. Dale. What are you saying then?
Not much.
No.
You got this real bad routine, yeah?
It's good.
It's good? Yeah. You want to check it out with some of my music, huh?
No. You don't need your music. We got the human beatbox.
Yeah, know what I'm saying?
Check this out, listen. Cut. Do we need music?
Yeah,
you still need music. The music's still fresh.
Bring the camera over this way.
Hey, you have to get straight onto the camera, don't you?
Yeah. All right, show me, all right? Come on, show me.
No, what?
Okay.
The final video will be edited together as a story and will include breakdancing, body popping, rapping and graffiti art by talented young people from all over the county.
Now, if you look to the viewfinder, right, you get your up against it and bring this hand round under here. Into this grip.
Which one am I at? This one?
Yeah. And put your hands through, here. Through there. Right?
And I think you should know how to use it. You shouldn't always rely on somebody else to do it for you. Get involved in every aspect of this video and you know that you've done something towards it.
So it doesn't come in, but you're sort of getting quite a good sound from them. OK.
Is this on?
No, I'll put it on so it's ready to go.
Well, I'm a ones, I'm a leading rapper of all time. I rock on the mic from 9 to 10. And when I dominate the mic, I say you can't pretend that I'm the king, y'all. And I just won't stop. And when I dominate the mic, you know I'm hot.
My name is TK Rapper, that is true. I'm here to show you what a rap can do. Because I've got the sound and I've got the beat. And I'm dancing now with my golden feet. I was walking down the street the other day. Just let my radio play away. I don't care what the people say, because I know that the rap is here to stay.
Great. Oh, I'm doing
that.
Was
it like
great? Yeah.
Do you want to do it again?
This is a regular meeting of the users group, an elected body of active members of the workshop. They allocate the use of equipment and administer the money which Media Arts receive from the Southern Arts Association. It's their responsibility to decide how best to distribute this money amongst the many groups who apply for it.
What do I want to make a film about?
Hardcore.
Yeah, it's got to be called Hardcore. It's got to be about all the punks, not just the Swindon punks, about the punks everywhere.
Punk is just a movement. Someone once defined punk as being what, doing whatever you want to do.
And what do you think about this, Stomach?
Punks make themselves society's rejects. But who wants to belong to this anyway? It's horrible.
It's about being able to take part in a very creative activity and get the enjoyment that goes along with that. It's also about communication, being able to engage in what is, after all, probably the most powerful form of communication we've got today. And although that sounds a little daunting, I think it's really only like reading and writing. People can and should be able to engage in making video programs as a way of expressing their views, their culture, their situation, whatever.
A convoy of cruise missile carriers travels through the English countryside at night. Its progress is recorded by a group which is opposed to the stationing of American nuclear missiles on British territory. Swindon's Cruise Watch members document and publicise activities and events relating to cruise, which they feel are inadequately reported on TV and other news media.
There's like three launches coming up, and I think I see two control vehicles. So it should be within about 4.5 minutes. Over.
Thanks, Snapdragon. Got that. We'll be ready.
When we first started using video, it was because we weren't getting sufficient coverage, in our view, in the media of what was going on. So we decided to take our own cameras out and film what we could.
If we can find somewhere to stop at the top of here, this is actually the end of the ranges. So there should be signs and things that we can actually get something of.
Cruise Watch is opposed to the presence of American nuclear bases in Britain, and the video team records events which they regard as support for their point of view. In this sequence, protesters are recorded staging a picnic demonstration at a missile base on ground which they claim is a public right of way.
This is a video shot by the Oxford group at Croughton. And halfway through, about 2:50, there's a bit with the personnel in it.
As well as shooting its own videos, Swindon's Cruise Watch commissions material from CND supporters in other parts of the country. Here, they're looking at material sent to them by an Oxford group and choosing the best bits to include in their next video.
Well, that's good. They're well armed.
So what are you saying from about here?
Yeah, just after this police vehicle goes off.
What do you think, then?
Well, I like that bit that we just saw there with the police...
Change of shift.
...actually turning up.
And the gun on her, carrying on her back's quite good, and the fact that it's a woman's good as well.
I think the editing is most important because you can move sound around with the images. You can reinforce the images that you've got with the commentary. You can reinforce them with music, and you can reinforce them with additional sounds.
But as part of a whole thing, it would actually show people what was happening.
Cruise Watch don't try to be impartial. They use striking music and select and edit their images carefully to put over their point of view.
Preview.
Like many groups, they hire the centre's equipment to edit up to U-matic. Once completed, the videos are multi-copied and distributed to peace groups all over the country. They've already been seen by about 10,000 people.
Video is an extremely powerful medium for getting a message across. A lot of people can watch it collectively at once, and it immediately lends itself to a discussion taking place when the video is finished, unlike still photography, where only one or two people can look at a photograph at a time. You don't have any sound, you don't have any music with it, unless you go to very expensive lengths. Video's fairly economical, fairly cheap, and very, very powerful.
Through workshops like Media Arts Lab in Swindon, many people who might otherwise be intimidated by the technology or put off by the cost can now enjoy the excitement and creativity of making their own videos.
Now, realising people in the street have seen us working cameras, interviewing people, and making a video and doing something positive to show the way we want to live and the way our attitudes and styles and that. But I think it's got a lot of people to understand what we really like. They're not sort of looking down at you as if you're some type of, you know, used rubbish on the floor. We're just living the way we want to live, and we want to show everybody, especially the people that read the papers and think, you know, God, they're wasters. We're not real wasters, really. The camcorder is the lightweight recording miracle of the 80s, offering the enthusiast a means of producing exceptionally good results in a whole range of television production techniques. To gain these results, however, requires some specialist knowledge on the part of the operator.
To assist you in this area, What Video Magazine, in conjunction with Dixon's, have designed this short training tape. In it we shall cover four main headings.
Basic camcorder functions. Basic production techniques. Lighting techniques. production enhancement methods. Within each of these headings, we will examine the main rules and techniques required and show visual examples of how and how not to perform these skills.
The first subject we must look at is basic video camera functions. Without an understanding of the camera and the key principles involved, you'll be unable to understand the reasons for the various camera adjustments that have to be made. This training tape does not cover individual makes or models of camcorder, since the basic principles relating to each make and format remain the same, and the same setting up procedures are required. The controls remain fairly standard through most makes and models, and what must be remembered is that whilst the camcorder is a single unit, it's basically made up of a video camera and a video recorder. The camera part of the unit consists of a lens which throws an image onto the surface plate of the camera tube. The tube is the main component of the camera and is also the most vulnerable to misuse. The camera must never be aimed at the sun or indeed any other bright source of light. To do this will result in this happening. A burn on the faceplate that will in effect render the camcorder useless. Simple precautions will ensure this never happens, and we will explain how to protect your valuable equipment at the end of the program. Color television divides visible light, that is the light that is all around us, into three separate colors: red, green, and blue. These three colors, known as the primary colors, are chosen because when mixed in the correct proportions, they make white light. If we alter the proportions of these three primary colors, other colors can also be formed. In effect, this means that when we record for television, providing the white light is right, then all the other colors must also be right. This is the reason you have a white balance control on your camcorder. We'll look at how this adjustment is made later. But first, let's delve a bit deeper into visible light. That is, the light that is all around us. The sun and the light bulb. These are our most common sources of light. Yet, if you think about it, they both give off heat as well as light. In fact, they only give off light because they're hot enough to do so. Because the light is dependent on heat, visible light has what is called a color temperature. On your camera, you have a color temperature compensation switch, simply adjusted by switching to the sun position for outdoor shooting and the light bulb position for indoor shooting. Most camcorders use these or similar symbols. But what are we actually doing when we alter this switch? Well, white light, whether it be from the sun or a light bulb, comprises many different colors, and different sources of light contain different proportions of these colors. However, the human eye automatically compensates for these different colored elements. And of course, when we look at a white object, it always looks the same shade of white, no matter what source of light is illuminating it. This is not so on your video camera. During daylight hours, a video camera perceives that there is a bluish tint to the visible light. So, by switching to the daylight setting, we engage an orange filter to counteract the blue, and our picture then becomes near normal coloring. On the other hand, indoor lighting throws off a much more reddish light. So we must take off the orange filter by setting our camera to the indoor setting.
Rule 1. Always remember to set your color temperature compensation switch to the indoor or outdoor setting as required.
Because of this broad range of color temperature change, your color compensation switch cannot give a precise white balance. And for this reason, your camera is fitted with a white balance adjustment control. Most white balance adjustment systems employ an automatic push-button unit. To ensure perfect continuity of color registration throughout your production, you must make this adjustment whenever the light illuminating your subject varies, i.e. indoors, outdoors, sunny, cloudy, etc. To make the adjustment, first, check that the color compensation switch has been set to the correct position. Next, point the camera at a featureless white object under the light that will prevail during the recording. It's pointless setting the white balance on an object that is in the shade and then filming the object in the sun, as the color temperature will not be the same. Having determined a suitable white object, zoom in and fill the viewfinder screen with the object. Now press the adjustment control. It's as simple as that.
Rule 2. Always adjust your white balance to suit the prevailing conditions. When the conditions change, reset the balance to the new conditions.
Let's now move on to how the flow of light enters the camera. Well, it obviously goes through the lens, but to increase or decrease the amount of light entering the camera tube, we have an iris or aperture control. This function enables the correct exposure to be maintained under different levels of intensity of lighting. Most camcorders are equipped with an automatic iris control. It can be switched over to manual control for backlight settings. But generally, in most situations, your camera can be left on automatic, and you need not worry about the aperture setting. There are occasions, however, when you have to override the automatic iris. As you can see here, when the sky comes into view, the iris closes down due to the surge of light from the sky. The iris is confused. It has automatically adjusted itself to give correct exposure for the light emitted by the sky. But our subject, on the ground, is in darker surroundings and ends up being underexposed. To avoid this effect, switch to manual iris and open up the iris to give correct exposure to your subject. If your camcorder has a backlight setting, this too helps avoid the iris prematurely closing down. Video photography is very similar to ordinary photography in lighting requirements, and a clearer, sharper picture will be obtained by shooting your subject with the sun behind your back.
Rule 3. Be prepared to switch to manual iris to avoid premature iris closure.
Let's now look at the zoom lens. If you wish to avoid making your audience seasick, avoid doing this. The zoom lens is an ideal tool to shift your viewer's attention from a tight shot to a wide overall view, but must be used sparingly. It was originally designed to enable the cameraman to get closer to his subject without the need to physically move the camera closer. But more about the zoom lens later. At the end of the zoom lens is situated the focus ring. Although many camcorders are fitted with automatic focus, it's essential to know the simple rule of focusing, which is, whilst your recorder is in the pause mode, zoom in tight on your subject. Adjust the focus ring until you gain a clear, sharp picture. As you now zoom out to a wide shot, focus will be maintained between the subject and your camera. Now you can begin recording. If you wish to close in on your subject, you will maintain correct focus. Forgetting to adjust your focus prior to recording will result in this happening.
Rule 4. Prior to zooming in on a subject, always preset the focus on the tight shot before actually recording.
Let's now move on to part 2 of our program, Basic Production Techniques. Production techniques with the camcorder are similar to those of standard video film production. However, taking into account that you own an all-in-one unit that gives a nice clean edit between scenes, then it would be a definite advantage if you can shoot production without the need for any further two-machine editing. This can be done, and it will become second nature with practice. Looking at this piece of film, it is a typical amateur attempt. Zooming, panning, wobbling, out of focus, and quite frankly, boring. Here we see the film shot again, but this time using thought and production techniques. Now doesn't this look more interesting? You've probably already forgotten that there's a cameraman behind the camera. The art of good production is precisely that, to make the viewer aware only of the pictures on the screen and not the cameraman behind the scenes. So let's now show you how to get these results. First, let's concentrate on three main shots. We have the wide-angle shot. This establishes our subject within the surroundings, but notice how our subject is not very prominent. The mid-shot makes our subject more prominent and still retains some of the background. The close-up shot focuses our viewer's attention firmly on the subject, but it would be difficult to establish the location of the subject in relationship to the surroundings if we used only this shot. By using steady camera work and varying these three shots, pausing out the zoom actions in between the shots, we get a varying montage of pictures that make an interesting scene. And obviously we have a range of in-between shots available to us as well. Let's now discuss how you can use your camcorder to add interest to your productions and enhance the scenes. We generally use our camcorder to take pictures of moving subjects. By adding movement to our camera, we greatly increase the impact of our pictures. The first main camera movement to consider is the pan. We use this movement to transfer the viewer's attention to another aspect. Only pan one way and hold the shot for a few seconds at the end of the movement. The tilt is used in a similar way, but this time moving up or down. When shooting high objects, distortion can occur, and although your eyes will tell you the building is tall and straight, your camera may show it leaning. The main reason for this is that when we look up at a high object, or indeed tilt our heads to one side, our brain compensates for the movement and shows the view as horizontal. The video camera has no brain and shows you exactly what it sees. If the camera is not straight with the horizon, then your picture ends up like this. These shots were simply taken from the back of a second car, yet the viewer immediately considers themselves to be riding down the road with the subjects on screen. Here again, the camera is being carried low down, and the viewer is immediately transported to trekking through the undergrowth. This effect is often used in horror films, especially with sound effects added. We know your camcorder comes with a power zoom, and we know you can't wait to use it. But unless the zoom is used correctly, it's best not used at all. So how do we use the zoom correctly? Well, the slow zoom in is mainly used to direct your viewer's attention to the main point of interest. But never zoom into a subject and then out again. It looks amateurish and adds nothing to the production. The slow zoom out can always be used to establish your subjects within their surroundings. Always use the zoom action sparingly and try to avoid using both zooms in and zooms out within close proximity to one another. And remember, on a long wide shot, you have a broad focus adjustment and an excellent depth of field. As you start to zoom in tight, then your depth of field is greatly reduced. And unless you've set your focus to your subject prior to the zoom, as we explained earlier, you will very likely lose focus. So far, so good. You now know the basic movements and shots. Next, you must learn how to frame these shots in your viewfinder. If you imagine your TV screen is a picture in a frame, you would want to see a picture that is pleasing to the eye. For television, we must film our subjects in a certain way that not only looks good, but also conveys a message to our viewer.
Framing rules. There are several important rules to remember regarding the framing of the subjects whilst out recording, and these are: always keep your subject in the middle of the frame, and any shots that are less than full length should have the top of the head near the top of the frame. The exception to this rule is as follows. When filming your subject watching, talking, or listening to another subject off-frame, leave a looking space. Here, our subject is looking, admiring the view. When we leave the looking space, our viewer's eyes and brain are instinctively waiting to see what our subject is looking at. We can add any picture we want. We always get the same impression. Our subject is looking at that. When recording your subject walking, then again, we must leave a greater space in front of the subject than behind. The reason for this is that our viewer's eyes and brain relate to the picture more easily because they can see in advance where our subject is going. If filming two or more people, then your subjects must sit or stand surprisingly close together to look natural on screen. When your subject is leaving the scene, an exit diagonally towards the camera looks far more effective than walking straight out of the side of the screen. And whenever possible, use a tripod. A wobbly camera means a wobbly picture, and that can be very distracting for your viewer. This is especially necessary when on a tight shot, as you can see the slightest movement on your recorded picture. When recording solid objects, for example this car, take an oblique shot. It gives far more depth to your picture than this side shot of the same subject. And finally, flat objects, such as pictures or plaques on a wall, should always be filmed straight on. This avoids distortion.
Right, now we know the basic rules of how to compose our pictures, let's move on to linking shots. What do we mean by linking shots? Well, obviously you could go and spend a day with your camcorder filming anything and everything that moves. And at the end of the day, you end up with masses of footage that will bore even the most loyal member of your family. However, using a little thought, a little self-restraint, and a lot more pause control, you could produce what will be a pleasant, informative production. Let's look at some filmed footage and discuss in greater detail the principles of successfully linking shots together. First of all, we have to decide what message we wish to portray to our viewer. For our example, we're going to show a couple arriving with car and caravan at their holiday destination. We want to make this sequence short but informative. Our first shot of the sequence shows a nice long shot of our subjects travelling towards the camera. We pause immediately the caravan goes out of the viewfinder. The next shot offers our viewers a chance to see where our subjects are travelling to, and we successfully bring into view their arrival. Once the car has stopped, we again change angles to dramatise the shot. And pause. Moving the camcorder once more to the front of the subject, we frame our subject entering the building. For our next shots, we have a complete change of scenery as we move into the pool area. This type of shot makes an ideal opener for a scene change. To maintain continuity, take careful note of the position of the subject's main movements. The coffee cup is the linking movement here. The next camera position picks up this movement and follows the shot through. Now pause. We can now close in on the hand in the water shot and follow the movement round. And pause. To finish the sequence, we take a low angled shot and have our subjects walk towards us and move out of shot each side of the camera. Let's now watch the sequence again in full. We'll be right back. We're not suggesting that you would want to go to all this trouble with all your home productions, especially holiday films. But if you pay attention to detail and concentrate on linking shots together to give a smooth flow of pictures, your final presentation will be more acceptable. Another way of linking subjects is by using the focus ring. These effects are produced by a method known as switch focusing. It's an artistic method of transferring your viewer's attention from one subject to another. It's simply performed by first focusing on a close subject and then revolving the focus ring to bring the second subject and background into focus.
Rule 6. Link your shots, not only to add visual interest, but also to strengthen the message you wish to portray to your viewer.
Let's now move on to lighting. Although video is an excellent medium, it has one slight drawback, and that is that to gain a clear, sharp picture in poorly lit situations, extra carefully placed lighting is required. Lighting techniques obviously vary to suit individual situations, but you'll find most subjects require at least three different basic lighting sources. The main light is the key light. This is used to establish the light direction, as well as revealing the modelling and texture of our subject. A focused spotlight is used as the key light and is placed higher than and to one side of the camera. To counteract the shadows the key light produces, we must now use a fill light. The fill light should be a softer light placed on the opposite side of the camera in a lower position. These two lights on their own will illuminate our subject sufficiently. However, to create a three-dimensional illusion and add depth to our scene, a backlight is required, placed above and behind the subject. These three lights form the basis of well-prepared lighting. However, in addition to these lights, you may need to use extra lights to illuminate the actual background scene. If you're short of space, or indeed only have one lamp, you can bounce light off white surfaces, walls, ceilings, or, as you can see in our example, a photographic reflector. Note how, as we bring the reflector closer, the light on the face increases, yet we're only using one lamp. If you're planning to shoot indoors regularly, then we suggest you purchase some proper video lighting. What about these shots? How can they be achieved? Easy, using low-cost filters that slot into the front of the lens. Available from most good photographic stores. There are dozens of special effects filters that, although designed for still photography, they give an excellent effect on video. Video photography can be an all-year-round hobby, offering many different programming variations and projects for you to tackle. We want you to enjoy using your camcorder and to realize its full potential. We also want you to protect it from simple but costly accidents. Follow these simple rules and your camcorder will give you years of excellent service.
Always fit the lens cap when not in use, even between shots if necessary. This will avoid accidentally aiming at the sun.
Don't bring the unit from the cold into a warm room and operate straight away. Moisture could form on the recording head drum, and this would then stick to the videotape and cause the tape and the tape heads to be ruined.
Don't leave the unit on the parcel shelf of your car. Apart from it attracting thieves, if the sun is shining, the heat could warp the unit and again render it useless.
Have the unit serviced regularly by a reputable dealer, and don't attempt to clean the video heads yourself. They're extremely delicate.
Keep the unit away from sand. One grain of sand could scratch the lens or get into the video recording heads and cause expensive repair bills.
We hope you found this production interesting, informative, and useful. Goodbye.
We'll be right back.